You're calling us, and so we are gathered here. You're building us into a house of prayer. A holy place where stories of grace are told, a sacred space where miracles unfold. And praises rise from the offering of our lives. Let's fill this house. Let's fill this house. Call the seeker. Call the stranger. Call the children. Let's hear them.
Welcome to our service this morning. It's great that you're able to join with us, and it is just so such a blessing that so many people have been joining and sharing with us week by week. And feel free to encourage others to watch these services, and just pray that it's a blessing to as much a blessing to others as it is to you. And thank you again. We're going to follow this service unannounced, so just as we work our way through. And we're going to start the service with a song. Feel free to either sing along, if you've got room, dance, or just listen, whatever you want to do. But let's just continue to worship God as we sing together.
Great is thy faithfulness. thy compassions they fail not, as thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, morning by morning new mercies I see.
Let us pray together. Father, we thank you for your church, for that company of faithful people who have through the centuries followed the way of life set out for them in your Son, Jesus Christ. We confess that we, your people, are not what we ought to be. You have declared us one, but though we all acknowledge Jesus is Lord, in many ways we are divided. You have called us holy, but we are not yet holy in all that we do, or obedient in all that we undertake. We call ourselves Catholic, but too often we are more attached to our own ways and prouder of our own peculiarities than to confessing the faith of the universal church. We claim to be apostolic, but do not always show the single-minded faith of those in whose footsteps we profess to follow. Lord, forgive all these our shortcomings, our lack of zeal for your gospel. We pray for all who sincerely call themselves Christian in whatever country and whatever race, whatever their peculiarities of worship or of organisation, Help us all to see what is important in your eyes and what is trivial. Bring us closer to you, and so closer to each other, we pray, as we offer this prayer in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen.
Express our love to you in worship and praise before your throne. Blessed be your holy name.
The Bible reading is taken from Ephesians chapter 5, verses 1 to 17. Imitate God, therefore, in everything you do, because you are his dear children. Live a life filled with love, following the example of Christ. He loved us and offered himself as a sacrifice for us, a pleasing aroma to God. Let there be no sexual immorality, impurity, or greed among you. Such sins have no place among God's people. Obscene stories, foolish talk, and coarse jokes, these are not for you. Instead, let there be thankfulness to God. You can be sure that no immoral, impure, or greedy person will inherit the kingdom of Christ and of God. For a greedy person is an idolater, worshipping the things of this world. Don't be fooled by those who try to excuse these sins, for the anger of God will fall on all who disobey him. Don't participate in the things these people do. For once you were full of darkness, but now you have light from the Lord. So live as people of light, for this light within you produces only what is good and right and true. Carefully determine what pleases the Lord. Take no part in the worthless deeds of evil and darkness. Instead, expose them. It is shameful even to talk about the things that ungodly people do in secret. But their evil intentions will be exposed when the light shines on them. For the light makes everything visible. This is why it is said, "Awake, O sleeper, rise up from the dead, and Christ will give you light." So be careful how you live. Don't live like fools, but like those who are wise. Make the most of every opportunity in these evil days. Don't act thoughtlessly, but understand what the Lord wants you to do. Amen. And now our prayers of intercession. Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you for this beautiful day. It's the day you made, and we praise you for it. Thank you for our families and friends. We praise you for them, Lord. Among all that we have, there are so many hurting and needy people. And in the quiet now, we think of those that we know or come to mind. We lift them up to you and ask that you would bless them, help them, heal them. May your peace fill their hearts and may joy shine. We ask that you intercede for them, fulfilling their needs according to your will. We also pray that you would use us to help them in any way we can. Lord, open our eyes and make us aware of opportunities we have to bless others in need. Help us not to be selfish, but help us to share. All that we have is yours, and we surrender to you. And we commit this prayer to you, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Sweet the sound that I don't know about you, but the last few months that we have just been through have seemed very strange and at times uncertain. They've certainly been the most unprecedented times that I've lived through. And I understand that some people have felt very fearful and others have felt at times very emotional. But let me ask you, as you look back over the past few weeks, how is your relationship with God? How is your relationship with God? Often when we face times like this, it's so easy to be focused on the things that we're facing and the things that we're experiencing that it can lead to a sort of spiritual lockdown, a spiritual inaction. But God's word gives us direction for our everyday lives, even the days that are challenging and difficult, so that we can redeem the time and to use every opportunity for the good and for God. Normally, both Linda and I are very busy. We're involved in quite a number of things that happen at church each week. But then we got we had a telephone conversation with our GP practice, who told us because of the threat of COVID-19, we had to stop doing the things that we were doing. Many of you may have had similar things happen to you. And we found that so challenging. If I'm honest, initially, we felt a real sense of guilt about what we were having to stop doing and about other people having to carry on doing things that we'd started. And then we suddenly found that we had so much time that we were not used to. Time and space. And so we've begun to pray more, to study more, and to listen more. And I would encourage you to think about how you use this time effectively and for God. In Habakkuk chapter 3 and reading from verse 17 to 19, we read this. Even though the fig trees have no blossoms and there are no grapes on the vines, even though the olive crop fails and the fields lie empty and barren, even though the flocks die in the fields and the cattle barns are empty, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in the God of my salvation. The sovereign Lord is my strength. He makes me as sure-footed as a deer, able to tread upon the heights. I don't know if you know those words, but in this prayer, Habakkuk affirms that even in the most difficult and challenging of times, he would still rejoice in the Lord. Habakkuk's feelings were not controlled by what was happening around about him, the events that were happening, but by his deep-rooted faith in God, knowing that this God would give him strength. When nothing makes sense and when troubles seem more than you can bear, remember, it is God who strengthens us. Take your eyes off your difficulties and focus on God. So Habakkuk offers some very important and some very practical thoughts. Keep the joy of the Lord if you trust him for eternity. Trust him not just for what's going to happen in the future, but for the right now, for the situations we're facing. Remember, your strength comes from the Lord. Let him lift you up and support you. And at all times, let us keep our eyes firmly fixed on God. So turning to the passage that Linda read for us, that came from Ephesians. Ian shared recently a series based on the prayers in the book of Ephesians, where we were reminded that this book was written by the Apostle Paul whilst he was actually in lockdown. He was a prisoner chained in Rome. He dictated the words that we read in the book of Ephesians. And I'm sure if anyone had the right to complain, it was Paul. But as we read this letter in Ephesians, it is a letter full of hope and of positive encouragement. Paul reminds us that it was for this very reason that we were called to be God's children. What moment? The hard moment. The things that you and I are facing right now in our lives. In chapter 4, Paul has shared how the unbelieving world thinks and lives. He has revealed to us something of the way of the Christian pathway. The conclusion is that we're not like the unbelievers. We no longer think like them, and we certainly should not behave and live like them. So in our Christian life, if we're going to live differently from the unbelieving world that is around us, and if we're going to know how to act and to respond in the very situations we face in life, we need to copy. Well, says Paul, if you need to copy someone, copy God. So let me share 4 brief points from this passage that hopefully you will be able to apply in your lives today. And the first one comes from verse 1 of that passage in Ephesians 5. And it says, be imitators of God. Be imitators of God. Children love to imitate their parents. And they often demonstrate this at the most of inappropriate moments. Ian, again, I think, reminded us recently of the amount of time it takes an impressionist to learn how to fully imitate the person they're trying to be. It could take years of study and very close observation. Paul tells the church at Ephesus they need to imitate God. That takes considerable time. It means that we need to understand. We need to really know God well. And so the challenge is, if we're to imitate God and to discover and know him, then we need to spend time with him. You may have heard the story of Robert Powell, the actor, who, after acting as Jesus of Nazareth in the BBC series, spent a number of years without being able to secure any other roles. And he found it quite frustrating. And he would often ring his agent and say, is there no work? And eventually his agent said, the problem is this, that people, when they see you, see Jesus. I wonder if that's true for us, that people see Jesus in us. You may recall that John the Baptist prayed that he might grow less and less so that Jesus may grow more and more. Maybe we need to make that our prayer every day. We grow less and less so Jesus can grow more and more. Be imitators of God. The second thing I want to share with you is in verse 2. It says, live a life filled with love. Live a life filled with love. The love of Jesus for each of us led Jesus to die at Calvary. He loved the world so much that God gave his only begotten Son so that we might live. And our response and our love to others needs to go beyond affection to the same self-sacrificing love as demonstrated by Jesus as he died on the cross. We are called to walk in love. Paul puts it like this: if we're going to imitate God, then God is love. And we need to find practical ways to demonstrate that love in very positive ways to a world that at times is very dark and very cruel. I don't know about you, but at times it seems that our world is so focused or motivated by about gaining advantage over others. The common cry for many is, what's in it for me? And yet we look at the cross, that object of love, and we see what it cost Jesus. Unattractive, undeserving. How do we show love, even to those who we find it difficult to show love to? None of us ever deserved for God to love us the way that he does. Yet he loves us. And he showed that love by sending Jesus to be involved with us. We are called to be imitators of that love, to walk in love even when we face fear, walk in love when we feel probably very frustrated, walk in the realization of God's love when we know we are in an unlovable state. James reminds us, the book of James, that love should not just be a matter of words or talk, but it needs to be genuine and it needs to show itself in action. When we actively seek to imitate God's love, then that will transform our worlds and the people we meet. The third point I want to share is our purpose is defined in verses 3 to 14. Our purpose is defined. We're made holy through Jesus Christ. It is through Christ that the Holy Spirit is at work within us. And it's very clear from these verses, verse 3 to 14, that we're not to live like the world. We are to be distinctive. We're to be salt. We're to be light. And this section of the passage gives some very both helpful and practical advice as how we should live as Christians. The challenges about being Christians in our world whilst not being in the world. My Uncle Tom used to say to me from time to time when I was a teenager, if you hang out in a coal mine, you're only going to get dirty. And he used to say that to convince me to avoid associating with the wrong sort of people. And he had every good intention in saying that. But there is, with this advice, the temptation that we isolate ourselves away in some sort of self-imposed lockdown. And many have interpreted this and other scriptures to lead them to isolate themselves and even their congregations from the world that they're a part of, lest they become contaminated. But for me, when we do that, we isolate ourselves from the very people that Jesus spent most of his time with. The reality is that if you're hanging out in a coal mine, you will get dirty. Most of my family were coal miners in Leicestershire. I believe Jesus got a lot of dirt on him as he tried to walk a way of love. It can be very, very dirty business. Loving the unlovely is not always something that is a pleasant experience. But is that not our calling? Does not God call us as Christians to live in the places where we are, to demonstrate in very practical and loving ways that we know Jesus? In John 9, verse 5, Jesus reminds us, while I am in the world, I am the light of the world. Jesus remained faithful to God despite all sorts of distractions that he faced. And as we walk through the world, we need to be watchful. We need to guard against those temptations. And as we seek to imitate God, we guard against all impurity. So there is much work that needs to be done here for Jesus. Maybe this is an opportune time in these days to just pause, to stop, and to focus on the real priorities of our lives. Maybe a time for a spiritual spring clean, getting rid of all those things that get in the way and distract us from following Jesus. And we need to stop looking back and begin to look forward. And the fourth thing I want to share, and last point, we need to live by the Spirit's power. And that's verses 15 to 16. We need a sense of urgency because these days are really difficult and testing. We must keep our standards high. We must act wisely and we must do good whenever we can. In verse 16, some really challenging words in this passage in Ephesians 5. It says, it talks about the concept of making the most of every opportunity. How relevant that is for us today. Some of us are finding themselves with their children for the first time, being at home every day, both as it was during the school term because they weren't at school, and now during the holiday with very little else they can do and very little facilities open. Some have been laid off and are finding themselves at home with their spouses continually and finding that really, really difficult and testing. Some are having to eat their own cooking every day because they can't go out to cafes or takeaways, and they're certainly not enjoying it. Paul would remind us that these moments need to be redeemed. And though it's not normal, each moment has to be used for God's own purpose. Unless we intentionally make use of the moments that God gives us, then sadly they will just drift away, never to return. So it is about setting our hearts and our minds intentionally on imitating Jesus and walking as children of light. And so as I sum up, in conclusion, we need to be intentional in what we do, in the way that we walk for God, about praying every day, about studying God's word, about spending time listening to him. These things are fundamental, but yes, they're so important. God grants to us so many opportunities to re-evaluate our priorities. What's really important? What's really, really important? And let us be intentional in making those things happen. In Deuteronomy verse chapter 31, verse 8, we read this: "Do not be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord will personally go ahead of you. He will be with you. He will neither fail you nor abandon you." So let us just pause and pray together. Lord, we just thank you for your word, these words written by Paul whilst a prisoner in Rome to the church at Ephesus, that remind us to keep our eyes firmly fixed on you, that we may grow in the knowledge and in the love of Jesus, and that we might show that to the world that is hurting around us. So, Lord, send your Holy Spirit to each of us to empower us in all we do for you. Amen.
Where feet may fail, and there I find you in the mystery, in oceans deep, my faith will stand, and I'll call upon your name and keep my eyes above. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, you are mine. Your grace abounds. Surrounds me, you've never failed, and you won't stop now. I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul. I am yours, and you are mine.
Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters, wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander. My faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters, wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters, wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander. My faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior.
Thank you for joining us today. It's great that we've been able to share in the worship together, and just pray that God will keep you safe during the coming week and keep you blessed. And so let's share the grace as we close. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen.
I will offer up my life in spirit and truth, pouring out the oil of love as my worship to you. In surrender I must give my every part. Lord, receive the sacrifice of a broken heart. Jesus, what can I give? What can I bring to so faithful a friend, to so loving a King? Savior, what can be said? What can be sung as a praise of your name? Could not tell, not even in part, of the debt of love that is owned by this thankful heart. This thankful heart. This thankful heart. You deserve my breath, for you've paid the great cost, giving up your life to death, even death on the cross. You took all my shame away, that defeated my sin, opened up the gates of hell, and have beckoned me in. Jesus, what can I give? What can I bring? So faithful a friend, to so loving a King. Savior, what can be said? What can be sung as a praise of your name? For the surrender, I must give my every part. Lord, receive the sacrifice of a broken heart. Lord, receive the sacrifice of a broken heart. Lord, receive the sacrifice of a broken heart.